I started at the CDC in 1990 as a postdoc after actually doing field research in Central America, trying to figure out how viruses, which many of the investigators in the United States were using as laboratory tools, were actually causing real disease in animals. In this case, it was an animal virus in Central America. It really got me turned on to this idea of bridging the gap between what we do in a very intricate, methodical, technical way in the laboratory, and how that information can then be put to work in the actual field. Not just make it work, but then translate that work into actual ways to objectively diagnose what it is that's going on in the field, identify agents, identify disease, and at the same time, once we identify it, what we can do with it. We have an enormous amount of technology at our fingertips. We can put people on the moon, we can talk to people all over the world instantaneously. We have unbelievable technological capabilities. Yet at the same time, we don't necessarily apply those technological capabilities in areas that are of utmost importance to our health and well-being. And I think really, can't hear you? Can't hear me? Is that better? Medicine, science in medicine, is actually one of the areas that has not taken advantage of a lot of our technological capabilities as much as business, telecommunications, et cetera, have. But I think we've entered into a new time, the time of social media, the time of technology, and the recognition that the coming together of these two things has really brought some of our tremendous public health problems to the forefront of the world. And so it gives us the opportunity to say, what are we going to do about it? How are we going to fix that? How do we move forward? Enough of the, well, we can sequence a genome. Let's now get that sequence of the genome and put it to work for us. Let's use that information to help treat people that need the treatment, help diagnose people that need to have the diagnosis in order to get that treatment. So rather than spend my next 45 minutes to an hour giving a talk like I gave this morning, which is very, very technical, you know, talking about the genetics, talking about those genes, talking about the viruses, talking about the immune stuff. We have that bolus of knowledge. How are we going to take that knowledge now and move forward so that we can solve CFS? So that's what I'm going to try to hopefully inspire you and give you hope that I do think it's a very new and exciting time in this area of CFS and fibromyalgia, and that we will move forward. This is, I think, probably one of my most technical slides. You've heard a lot, I think, over the past several years, and specifically over the past year, about a number of different types of molecules, a number of different types of viruses or various agents that can cause disease. These can be considered biomarkers. So you will probably hear the word biomarker a lot from now on out, not only from me, but from science and in medicine in general, because medicine is moving towards a system that needs these biomarkers, which are objective measures in order to be able to do what we need to do in order to diagnose and treat disease. It's important to remember that a biomarker for a disease is not just one thing. It could be many things. It could be many indicators. There could be a biomarker that indicates you just were infected with something. In that case, it might be a virus. There could be another marker which indicates the treatment for your disease is working. So the fact that, I don't have a pointer, do I? No. But if you look at that diagram, kind of think of it as a timeline. Think of it as a series of events that can occur in your life or in a period of time in your life. Biomarkers can be different throughout that. They can also be stable throughout that. They can be affected by your behavior, whether or not you smoke, whether or not you exercise, whether or not you had a car accident. They can also be affected by your basic genetic foundation, the blueprint of each one of us, which is our genomic material. All of these things work together to affect the kind of biomarker or biomarkers that we can find and use in order to, again, be objective about diagnosis and also be objective and quantitative about various types of treatments. These are incredibly important tools for scientists, number one, and most importantly, for the physicians who are trying to treat people that have complex chronic diseases such as CFS and fibromyalgia. So give me a show of hands. Does everybody kind of have an idea or a sense of what biomarkers are? Yes? Good. Okay, I just wanted to give you a few examples of what biomarkers are or can be. First of all, a biomarker that ends up in the hands of Dr. Bateman are biomarkers that have been reproduced by other laboratories, first of all, before it actually gets to the clinic. So in the laboratory, many people have to be able to reproduce it. If they don't, it means it could potentially be a spurious finding, or for whatever reason it's spurious. They're doing it a little bit differently, they're looking at a different population. So a biomarker must be reproducible. Once it's reproduced by a number of people, the method that it's been detected and reproduced has to be validated. So that by the time it gets to Cindy's clinic, let's say it's a dipstick strip or something like that, that is a validated approach for reproducibly measuring that biomarker. So yes, unfortunately, it's complicated. It can be a relatively drawn out process, and for sure, it's unbelievably expensive to do this. But we have to have that type of quality assurance and control in what it is that we're measuring in order to be able to ultimately treat an individual or diagnose an individual in a way that ultimately improves their quality of life. Okay? That's why, unfortunately, there's also not very many biomarkers out there, because it is a long and complicated process. Towards the end of my talk, I hope to give you an idea of the movement that's really, I think, taking hold that's going to help us shorten the time and the cost that it takes in order to get a biomarker from my bench side to your bedside. Here's a couple of examples of biomarkers that have been reproduced and validated. So blood sugar, okay? People with diabetes. We can have a dipstick to take a little finger prick, see what the glucose level is, and that biomarker is an indication for whether or not you need to take your insulin shot. Okay? So this is a nice biomarker in that it's somewhat diagnostic, and it also can, it has treatment implications. Blood pressure. This is a very different kind of biomarker than something like blood sugar. Okay? Put a cuff on there. You're not taking any blood. You're not being stuck with anything. But yet it is an indicator, again, possibly diagnostic of some type of underlying disease, and also an indicator of some type of treatment or the necessity for some type of treatment. HIV detection, okay? This is diagnostic of infection, HIV. It's not necessarily indicative of AIDS, but these two are linked. We know that HIV causes AIDS. HIV is not only the etiologic agent of AIDS, but it's also a biomarker. HIV viral load, the amount of virus in somebody that has HIV infection, is an indicator of how well their treatment is working. So highly active antiretroviral therapy, for example, can be assessed by that person's viral load. The diagnosis of MS. Not too long ago, people that had MS, they were told that it was all in their head. And imagine, it is a lot in their head, but that it was imaginary. MS became more easily diagnosed, although there are still some problems with the advent of imaging. So here's an example of a diagnostic approach using technology to identify, to actually use an image as a biomarker of disease. So there are several other examples, but I think in reality, when you think about how many different types of diseases we have to live with these days, this is a pretty pitiful list.